Thank you for that introduction and this invitation. Happy to be amongst colleagues, for people who I meet very frequently in other international forum, and those who are meeting for the first time. So quite happy to be here. And I'm also quite impressed to be listening to this presentation. In my other job, I was a foundation head of the NCD Research Policy Unit. And one of the things we used to talk about in a good program is to move from bench to bedside. Bench research, meaning in the laboratory, looking at origins, the levels of genetics, genes have just done, and translating this in translational science to the bedside, either diagnostic or treatment techniques, and see how this can be exported to the population science, then translate population science to policy, and policy back to bedside, so that it's like a sample. Ask cardiologists like talking about the cardiac cycle, so this is like a research cycle and knowledge generation implementation cycle that changes policy and action for diseases and disease control. So I think it's a very good one, as has been mentioned by the dean. I'll ask our candidate, James Kayima, a few questions. Not all questions will have answers. I post questions which sometimes even here don't have answers, or maybe there are no answers in this room. So responses like, I don't know, it will be explored into very much welcome. In the earlier days in the University of Nairobi, we used to have an examination for MMed, where an MCQ where every right answer was given plus one mark, and every wrong answer was given minus one mark, and the pass mark was 50%. So if you attempted an MCQ exam of 200 questions, and you got 60 of them correct and 40 of them wrong, your mark is 20% and the pass mark is 50%. So this is basically to discourage people from guessing. In medicine, we believe in consultation and giving people opportunity for the best knowledge and the best skill that is available, so we don't guess. And the one that has not been failed, actually it's a very good point. It means one is going to explore. So I'm going to ask just a few questions. My opening question is, in this world in cardiology where a lot of people are going into a very exciting cardiac catheterization work, which is modern, and which in monetary terms is very well paying. Why would an upcoming cardiologist go to programs of old people like us, hypertension? Most of us started in the cath lab and stayed there for a while. It took us quite a while to wake up and find out where these complications are coming from. So what gave you this early awakening to join this field of hypertension and not in the cath lab, where I'm sure in case Western majority of people there come to the cath lab with coronary artery disease and you could nicely make sense and that was good suddenly.
Thank you, Professor Yonga. I do that as well, so I do sense as well. But I was lucky that before I learned to do that, I worked on an award, a cardiac skill award, where I noted that a lot of patients who came in had failure, and most of that had failure. We on that board described was due to high blood pressure. And so my interest in high blood pressure was aroused. And for my MA in thesis, actually blood pressure was a focus. So this work was actually to take forward an interest that I've had before. Now I do know the cool stuff as well. So when the opportunity showed itself to learn the cool stuff, I did go and learn that too. But the cool stuff is only done in one cath lab in Uganda, and we struggle even when people get complications from cardiac service factors to get them in this one cath lab. So, well, it's good for career, probably for the pockets it will be pasteurization. But for the wider good, it's probably good that the diseases, the risk factors of the diseases are described, and then the control is also, control procedures are also populated. So in my other work, I do a lot of advocacy in reducing those risk factors, and so I have a lay in more fields.
Thank you. So I would just ask you, what then do you think is the health and economic burden for hypertension in Uganda or East Africa or Africa per se? What you can either judge it as I know, or you can use some figures or some economic measurements or metrics, if you like.
Okay, so we know that the economic impact of hypertension in Africa is quite significant. Most importantly, because complications with hypertension occur a decade and a half earlier in Africa than elsewhere. You know, for example, compared to the Western world, the average age that someone gets afflicted with complications with hypertension because of stroke, heart failure, kidney failure in Africa is 53 years. Whereas the average age that happened in the Western world is about 62 years. So the people who get hypertension are the ones that are active and the ones that contribute quite significantly to the economy. So the African countries are more likely to lose a lot if we don't control this epidemic, if you want, as early as possible. But also, we do not have the fancy things to treat the complications of hypertension. So, in Uganda, we do have just for pasteurization laboratory, for example. So, if you are unlikely to get a heart attack, you're likely to die than access primary PCI. If you get kidney failure, the follows in the room will tell you that it's unlikely to have electrical access dialysis. So, and the cost of that is very, very high. So it's important that we do destroy these structures and prevent them as well.
Thank you. So what informed the conceptual framework that you made for this thesis, especially in doing study 1, study 2, study 3, and study 4? What overall theme or you know, higher goals that informed your choice of that conceptual framework and the division into two studies, and what were they achieving in concert?
Thank you very much, Professor, for that question. Our higher goal was to reduce cardiovascular morbidity and mortality in Uganda in particular, and certainly environments that are similar to ours. We're talking sub-Saharan Africa. And we were interested in studying the level of early treatment and control and to describe the risk factors for these particular variables, because we noted that, for example, what happens in North Africa does not happen in West Africa, and our systematic review informed us in that aspect. We looked at HIV infection, because HIV infection is highly prevalent. Now, in our reading, we noted that a lot of patients have had an increased, a described increased hypertension risk if they had HIV. So just imagine a situation where HIV is very highly prevalent, and you bring in hypertension, and that HIV is the risk factor for hypertension, what would happen to that population? So you're going to have a double burden of disease where you have both HIV and hypertension interacting with a lot of cases. Cardiovascular disease has been described to occur twice as much in HIV patients compared to HIV negative patients. And one wonders if hypertension is an intermediary in that particular world. So we wanted to see what's happening in Africa as regards that. And the genetics, of course, we know that if you have that we have an increased risk of hypertension among families, then within families and among families, if you had monozygosity, for example, their correlation of having hypertension would be 55%. So there are things there that about the heritability of hypertension that haven't been more described and reported to contribute to that discussion, especially because a lot of the work has been done in the Western world.
Yeah. Now, you know from your literature review that a lot of systematic analysis and meta-analysis have already been done in Africa, You know, there are papers in the Junior Journal, the others that you quoted. Dunzi from ASCA has also done that, and then the roadmap. You also know from the literature review that Uganda has already done the Uganda Step Survey 2014 and has a lot of epidemiology of the NCD factors, including hypertension. What value do you think your personal and refreshing epidemiologic study would play in terms of connecting your last three objectives as a specific question?
Given the past three objectives, or the last three?
Yeah, only the last three.
So, yes, number one, Juliet Harrow from England has done a systematic review. This systematic review of hypertension was published in 2007. And we know that things change. And we documented in some work that what happened a decade ago is not what's prevalent now. So we did the systematic review because we wanted to find out what the situation with hypertension is about 8 years later. And as regards the National NCD Survey, that National NCD Survey was very informative, but it didn't capture what was the capture in the study, which was what happened in these quick urbanizing environments, which is a lot of places in Uganda. Where there is a town, you don't have the sort of settlements that you saw, I showed in Wakiso, and then what happens in those sort of settlements. Now, the NCD survey, they need a very good global, yes, a good global view of hypertension, doesn't actually capture those specificities, and we know that our work on that is.
Now, I asked you something about your hypothesis too. Which stated that there will be no difference of HIV infection in hypertensive versus non-hypertensive. Would you think, is it no difference in HIV status for hypertensive or non-hypertensive, or is it no difference in hypertension rates in HIV positive and negative patients? Which is which in this hypothesis?
Okay, so maybe I didn't write it as well as I should. Certainly, the predictor variable is HIV and the outcome variable is hypertension. So it should be, as you stated, that there would be no difference in hypertension status among HIV participants and non-HIV participants.
A few questions on genetics as well. In your own reading and in your work right now, what do you think is the main mode of genetic determination of hypertension in Africa?
So, because we've described an institution of hypertension in Africa, we think that the mode of any determination is through the various forms of that actually simulated polymorphisms. We know that this polymorphism only accounts for up to 2 millimeters of mercury, and a lot of the other is contributed to by the environment. So in Africa, if you look at studies by Nelport and others, which describe the migration, where people who move from western side of Kenya and came to Nairobi, there was an increase in blood pressure compared to the state. It shows very clearly that the environment plays a major role in this. However, we still have that 2 millimeter of mercury blood pressure that's compared by the genetics as well. So a lot of environmental factors, but the genetics play a role as well.
So then do you think that the genetic interlinks between things like the obesity gene, insulin resistance, dyslipidemia, and hypertension gene, since we know that these physiological factors and their genetic determinants seem to occur together?
So, it's been difficult to describe, but we know that a lot of the genetic variants that have been described, for example, by hypertension, have been described for obesity as well, and their end result is causation of increased cardiovascular disease. So, it's been difficult to determine for which particular condition these particular variants confer, in particular conditions they confer. So there's probably a lot of interrelationships between the different cardiovascular phenotypes, the different risk factors that cause cardiovascular disease, and I think that would be something to study. Currently we know that there are efforts to try and lump together these cardiovascular risk factor phenotypes and also try describe the best fit of genetic variants that actually describe these cardiovascular variants. For example, if you have a patient who has the obesity, hypertension, diabetes, and they have a cardiovascular disease, what are the best similarly polymorphisms that can actually account for this? So I think that model would help in further describing
given what you said about changing populations and changing disease and epidemiology, what then do you think would be, because obesity is also something that is developing and is based on environmental factors as well. So what are the roles of things like epigenetics and genetic drift in terms of hypertension driving, the genetics driving the hypertension? Are they static? Are they changing? And is SNP the best way to study it?
So, epigenetics is the study of a fixed gene that actually whose expression is changed by the changing environment. And SNPs are certainly not the best way to study these epigenetics, but that's a new frontier for studying genetics of hypertension and other cardiovascular risk factors. I have to tell you that the study of these SNPs has been a little disappointing in where it started as a predictor of hypertension, mainly because its effect size hasn't been that big. Obviously, like I said, there are these efforts where now they are trying to use combination of SNPs to try and describe, you know, one phenotype. There is a study, for example, done in the UK, published last year, that Europe published last year. They noted that the top three SNPs accounted for up to 7 millimeters of mercury. Now, if you had the genetics of that, I think then we'll have a model that you better describe the genetics of our condition.
Thank you. So, Hypertension in Africa has previously been described as low-renin, salt-sensitive hypertension. And there are certain molecular mechanisms, putative molecular mechanisms that have been postulated. Renal natriuretic peptides, renins, etc. Degradation of angiotensins, etc., etc. So, are there any targeted proteins in your new studies that lends credence or destroys these previously proposed mechanisms of hypertension in Africa, which is different and makes Africans respond differently to pharmacologic agents, and indeed guidelines about this?
I think there's nothing directly in the study that will change, especially genetically, that will change what we think about that description of hypertension in Africa as the low rating type of hypertension in Africa. Yeah, you rightly state that Africans respond to blood pressure drugs differently from the rest. And the recent randomized controlled trial, the your study has described that we respond better to calcium and blockers. Better than any other drug. However, unless we did a study now on the pharmacogenetic contribution of these NIPs to the response to medication, maybe that's the best way that would give us more information on that. There have been NIPs that have been described to improve responses, especially in ACE inhibitors. But these NIPs have been described again in the Western population. We are not sure that, saying that the sleep contributes 2 millimeters of mercury would actually infer that that sleep would contribute to whether the calcium channel or an ACE inhibitor actually works to reduce blood pressure and therefore to control blood pressure.
Related to that, would the changes for the polymorphism on a single nucleotide be able to explore the effect that HIV may have on genetic expression that maybe controls hypertensive factors, or highly active antiretroviral drugs may have on genetic expression that controls hypertension?
Well, that would be an interesting study. I actually don't know if that would happen. Confer increased risk for HIV patients by hypertension, or if it will improve, say, the determination of antiretroviral therapy effect on obesity, for example. But if we study, I have come across any literature that has attempted to study that, so I can't really comment very authoritatively on that.
Taking your from genetics to your sample size calculation, you based your sample size of prevalence of hypertension at 15%. I was just wondering whether this was adequate power for study 3 to be able to detect differences in hypertension rates between the two groups, and how do you power for study 4?
So, for our study 3, we used a bigger study. The limits in this study that set out to look for cardiovascular disease risks in that population. And that calculation was actually for the bigger MECD study. And our study, what we did is after getting our proportions, we did a power calculation to see if all this work collected in the MECD study was well powered to answer our question one, and actually that work I mentioned was about 80, so we're confident that the differences that you get are actually that our study is more powered to determine the differences between the two. And I didn't go that other question.
The study form.
Study form, how we calculate
it? Yes. So sample size.
Yeah, so we need a power calculation for that sample size, it's in the book, it's somewhere in the book. And we had a power of 82% to determine the difference between those who had the sleep and those who did not have the sleep, the difference in intervention. But also we know that if you use that solid blood pressure and solid blood pressure continuous variables, that power actually goes up even further. So we are quite confident about our power for 84.
Okay, just down to some of your results. You had in the Wakiso district, of those who are aware that they had hypertension, 100% of them were treated. This is astounding, and I don't think there's any study anywhere that has any such results. Could you explain this? Because it is completely away from what studies we have on the epidemiology of hypertension.
We are surprised as well. But it could be down to three factors. The way we described treatment, one, we took everyone, if someone said they had any sort of treatment for hypertension, we took that as treatment. Now, we went ahead, because we are equally as surprised, to divide who was treated with pharmacological agents, who had non-pharmacological agents in a non-pharmacological version, and those who had more. Now, about 65% were actually treated with pharmacological agents. Now, even if you say that you can't document or you can't ensure adherence to non-pharmacological methods of management of hypertension, treatment of 65% is still quite, with pharmacological agents, is still quite high in Africa. You would say unprecedented, but we have North African countries that are reported as same treatment levels. So yes, there might have been a problem in the way we describe what hypertension is, rather treatment is, but still, even if you switch it the other way and look at just those who are treated with pharmacological agents, which as you know is easier to quantify, it will soon be quite a high proportion and presented in sub-Saharan Africa.
Yeah, on that, it will be interesting to know the questions that were in the questionnaire, how they were framed, and whether there were ascertainment or verification backups, like asking for names of medications or evidence of medication when they were last taken, so that one can standardize that response and compare with other studies. Parallel to that, in your qualitative data for IDI-independent interviews and key informant interviews, could you briefly describe how they were analyzed and interlinked with this?
So, we didn't do any qualitative analysis for the study, and maybe you would argue that that's a weakness in the study. Certainly, when you find when you have findings like ones that we had, it's important that you do some qualitative analysis to figure out why things happen the way you do. We had another part of the study that actually tried to look at part of the events in the study that tried to answer some of those questions, but in relationship to the scope, for example, work that I was involved in. And then we certainly were able to describe some of the things that affect control that pressure. For example, we know that these patients, a lot of the patients, do not know that hypertension is, you know, most of them when they are diagnosed with hypertension, they go and get a medication for one, and they are soon cured. So it wasn't one for this particular project, but we certainly looked at it in the wider CBD project.
Thank you. The other question is the implications of this significant proportion of people with pre-hypertension. And I noted a lot of them are young. What do you think is the meaning epidemiologic and hypertension control strategy? Meaning, what implications does it have for hypertension control? And what is the meaning of this in terms of the behavioral changes and the physiological changes, like you call it transition, epidemiological transition in Uganda. What and what implication does it have on hypertension control strategies?
So that's a very good question. We do know from studies elsewhere that pre-hypertension is actually a risk factor for cardiovascular. Now in Africa, a lot of our cardiovascular disease is actually attributed to hypertension. So, for example, the population at risk for stroke from hypertension is 91% as compared to, say, 54% in the same amount, which means that hypertension actually has a very big role to play in eventual cardiovascular disease. So, the implication is that if indeed we have a lot of patients, a lot of participants with hypertension, and hypertension for the higher point of it is contributes quite on a huge scale to cardiovascular disease, then we are going to have a burgeoning problem of cardiovascular disease in sub-Saharan Africa. Number two, there is implication to what we can do with them. Number one is we know that a lot of this hypertension can actually be treated using non-pharmacokinetics. That we have patients who walk into your room and you tell them your blood pressure is 130, you do another blood pressure measurement, and they're actually pre-hypertensive. You tell them to go on exercise, and if they're able to adhere to this exercise, they actually come back to the office and the blood pressure has actually gone down. But we've had the recommendation from the ACC, American Heart Association, that say that actually, if these patients are pre-hypertensive and they have a high risk of cardiovascular disease, they actually are hypertensive and they should be treated. It's doubtful whether the risk calculations in those countries actually are useful for us, because I think that cardiovascular disease is a different cardiovascular disease than what they have in the Western world. Only 7 to 10% of the total cardiovascular disease that we have in Africa is ischemic disease, and yet ischemic disease is the biggest cardiovascular disease they have in the Western world. A lot of our cardiovascular value is contributed to a stroke, so it's possible that the risk calculations that they're using don't apply to our setup, and that our approach to treating hypertension should be actually different for the hypertension and high risk. So, but also, if you go out of these patients and you say to them on treatment, when you are struggling to treat the hypertension that we have, then you may crush the healthcare providers. So, in my opinion, I think we should encourage in policy that people who are found to be hypertensive are encouraged to adopt non-pharmacokinetic control of hypertension. Because individual by individual, it works, as whether it works on a global scale is a lot of education and a lot of encouragement for these populations.
Yes, indeed, actually, the WHO best buys in the NCD declarations after 2011 emphasize the importance of primordial prevention, stopping people from getting hypertension and knowing why they get hypertension. And your study is actually contributing towards this by genetic studies and your repeat of the epidemiologic studies to seize opportunities for early, cost-effective, affordable interventions, especially for things like hypertension. And parallel to this, I noted that there was no plethoric use of the Uganda statewide survey in the discussions, and also the WHO HATS model for cardiovascular risk protection, which looks at comprehensive cardiovascular risk assessment rather than one aspect like hypertension. It encourages cardiovascular work teams to be able to comprehensively address from population prevention to primary care. Because of that, I would like you to ask you one fundamental question. What do you think the Uganda STEPS survey of 2014 implies on policies, Ugandan CBP policies for prevention of hypertension?
Thank you very much, Professor. Luckily, the Uganda STEPS survey and studies like ours have had a great impact on the NCD policy in Uganda. Yesterday, we had the National Peace Conference Day that was led by the successive president. So if studies like the NCD, the stepwise study that was done in 2015, and our study that was done in 2015, that have actually formed increased awareness to the problem of high blood pressure and other kind of service factors to the highest level. Right now, we know that the president goes around saying, look for better exercise, look for better eat better, because we cannot treat the complications that emanate from the non-controllable diseases. So I think studies like ours and the NCDs, the survey, have had such a huge effect on what is already, it's already starting to happen. It's not that waiting for it to happen.
So, what then do you think, if I was to ask you to mention one, or if you want to enjoy 1.5 or 2, main policy implications of your thesis to CVD and hypertension control in Uganda? One, or if necessary, two policy implications, major policy implications of your thesis to CVD and hypertension control in the Republic of Uganda?
One of them is new, and the other is an emphasis. The new one is this finding that once you jump from the age 39 and you go into the 40, above 40 age group, your risk, not risk, your odds of having blood pressure jump up fivefold. And it's terribly described elsewhere because a lot of the age blood pressure relationships have been, read, that have been busted. So I think advising that the national guidance includes blood pressure measurements for everyone above the age of 40, at least every year, would be a new addition to the guidance. The other is, of course, a re-emphasis on the non-pharmacological means to treat the hypertension.
I will keep the same format for what you think is a major research contribution of your thesis in two ways. One, in knowledge. What do you think is the major contribution to knowledge in hypertension in Africa, or Uganda in particular? And then two, one, in research methods.
So, for the knowledge, we've been able to describe the highest groups for hypertension. We probably have a new description for what's a very high risk group for hypertension. And we think that if this is put into the guidelines, we'll probably have quite a few reductions of hypertension that group of patients. As regards research methods, we looked at genetics in hypertension. We know that genetics is like going out and trying to figure out if I mother the for that matter now it's worldwide. 20 years ago, this man from Jeff Bezos started Amazon. There were so many other startups such as like Amazon, and out of 100, only one worked out very well. So we think that we are contributing to knowledge of genetics for hypertension. Our contribution is an addition on the knowledge of how genetics work to confirm hypertensive risk, and the need is not, We could argue that we got an impact. The someone in the class didn't know what to eat. We need to study that. But you could argue that the rest of the sleeves confirm only 2 millimeters of function. But it's only that way that we are going to get to the environment, which is how does hypertension, how does genetics predict hypertension risk?
Given your objectives, I think you've given 2 million answers for that. Because if I look at your objectives, objective one is already information available. Study one, study two. Study three is quite unique, and I think you've emphasized before, contrary to what you thought, hypertension is less common in HIV population. So I think that's very important knowledge. The second very important knowledge is that genome-wide studies between the Western countries and Africans are concurrent. And that's, I think, a very important beginning point for further genetic studies. So I think I'll amplify what you are emphasizing towards that direction. And then my almost last question is, what research and knowledge issues remain outstanding from your study? Research and knowledge issues which you think remain outstanding?
One is, we've been involved in all these efforts to control blood pressure. I mean, people are misunderstood. Even in areas where the treatment level is very high, the control is very poor. Okay, so you could argue that, you know, our description of treatment was small, but still, the control of hypertension was extremely poor. So I think there is a corner of knowledge that we are missing to determine what exactly is it that confers control of hypertension, especially because we know that control of hypertension is an urgent, that if you don't know about hypertension, you actually are not controlling the body. So we have this new field that's called genetic science, it's both knowledge and research that should be able to describe, tell us, you know, what are the problems there, but also to sort of determine and research to the appropriate solutions, especially in an environment like ours, where the resources are extremely low.
Last question. How do you think, if you get awarded the degree of a doctor or philosopher at Kayima University in the Faculty of Health Sciences School of Medicine, how do you think this thesis has prepared you for a career, one, in clinical medicine, two, as an academician and researcher, and three, as a health leader in the public of Uganda?
I'll start in three. They're laughing because they know that I'm already really in that field. So we've done a lot of advocacy work already. A lot of the we've contributed a lot to the new NCD policy. We are contributing to guidelines for the treatment of hypertension and cardiovascular risk factors. So we are actually, me and my colleagues are actually led in that field already. We are, I don't know if it's like that, we've been ordinance or your lesson that we came in a period where there was a big problem that had any members, and this problem was looking for leaders to take out. Leaders want the policy, the clinic, clinical leadership, and also site leadership. So we are feeling that void slowly but surely. So this PhD not only helps me in leading, because we've been leading already. We now are contributing efforts to describe better ways of treating hypertension in our population by describing what it is that affects the outcome of evidence for treating hypertension. So a lot of that already comes directly from my PhD work. And clinically, I know that I can finish my other informs me about how better